Connie, you kind of spoiled us this morning. I was waiting for you to get rolled up here again. After the way you sang this morning, you might be running up here. One day when we see Jesus, we're going to run to Him. Amen? I'm glad I'm here tonight. Amen? This is a good place to be. I'd rather be here than any cemetery in the world. Or any hospital. Now, I might be a little bit late here Wednesday, and then again, I might even not make it here Wednesday night. I got two kidney stones got to come out Wednesday. Brother Buddy told me if you drink a lot of lemon juice, they may go away. I've drunk so much lemon juice in the last 2 or 3 months, trying to avoid this situation I'm in.
Stonebreaker.
Well, this is my third round with kidney stones. I'm familiar with them. If you've ever had a kidney stone, they're bad. But anyway, Wednesday I'll have that done. So I may not make it back here Wednesday night, but Brother Walter said he would be more than glad to fill in for me. Right, Brother Walter?
Right.
Did you say that?
I said that.
Amen. The book of Genesis, if you have your Bibles, Genesis chapter 12. And how many of you are happy in the Lord just tonight?
Amen.
I'm so happy in the Lord. I just want to say to you that the Lord is precious to me. The Word of God is precious. Y'all probably realize that after preaching to you the last two Sundays, that I love the Bible.
Amen.
You know, Paul said he was circumcised on the eighth day. And in the law, Moses' law, every male was circumcised on the eighth day. And the reason they were circumcised on the eighth day, according to we just found out not too long ago, that there was an element in the blood after a newborn baby is born on the fifth and sixth day, it causes the blood to clot. We're just catching up with Moses' law, see? I don't know if y'all got that or not, but anyway. It was a good time to circumcise a Jewish male. And also, recent studies by the medical people is that, you know what? If you're circumcised, it cuts out a lot of cancers later on. So everything in what Moses did health-wise was good for them healthy. You know they done something good because I don't know if I read this in the Bible or not. But I believe those shoes lasted 40 years.
Amen. In the wilderness, 40 years.
Well, that is something. Even the proteins in their skin must have been good to not wear out that leather in them shoes. That was quite amazing you know how God provided for them and all these good, sweet laws and all these medical things that was a gift to the Israelite children as they was traveling through that wilderness for 40 years. So it's quite amazing. If you would, look with me in the Bible, Genesis chapter 12. Not only is the Bible historical and scientifically accurate, but it's also prophetically accurate as well. Everything that was prophesied in the Old Testament happened to come true. Y'all believe that?
Amen.
Amen. We got a wonderful book, don't we?
Amen.
Genesis chapter 12, God dealing with Abraham again, verse 1 and 2. Now the Lord has said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show you, and I will make of thee what? A great nation. And I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. How many of you believe that Israel has been a great nation since Abraham went out? Been blessed, still being blessed. Not only that, he brought them back into the land, didn't he? And now they're back in the land. But you know what? The prophetical things of the Bible are true. Now look with me, Deuteronomy chapter 28. And I can tell you that Israel has been hounded for thousands of years, ever since this prophecy. They've been hated by people all around the world. Hitler tried to destroy them. Deuteronomy chapter 28, if you have your Bibles, look with me. Over in Deuteronomy, just a few books over in the Scriptures. Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, what they call the Pentateuch. And quite interesting Scripture here, a prophetical Scripture, in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 65 and 67, it prophesied that Israel would be hounded by all nations. And boy, I tell you what, that is so true. They've been hounded, and nations have tried to kill them and destroy them, verse 65, and among the nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord shall give thee their trembling heart, and failing of eyes, and sorrow of mind, and thy life shall hang in doubt before thee. And thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have more assurance of thy life. Now, I want you to know something, that prophecy in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 65 and 66, is so true. Israel's been hounded ever since they've been a nation. Matter of fact, if you've been watching the news, they're still hounded by a little dictator in Iran. And I got news for him, as John Hagee said, I heard him the other day, saying, they better watch out, Israel. They better watch Israel spy in the sky, which happens to be a little Jewish guy. Russia and Iran better watch out, because you know what? God neither slumbers or asleep, and He's watching His people. Matter of fact, He's Jewish, by the way. Jesus. And they better watch out, because God has brought them back to the land. Look with me in Deuteronomy, and these prophecies, not only is the Bible so accurate in all the things scientifically and historically and prophetically, as we'll look in Deuteronomy chapter 30, and I hope you have your Bibles. I'm going to run through a few verses. Look with me in verse 3. Amazing thing. All the way back when Moses wrote the Pentateuch, Moses prophesied that the Jewish people would come back in the land. Hitler tried to kill Israel. All through the wilderness experiences, nation after nation tried to kill Israel. The Babylonians captured them. All through history, they were hounded by nations all over the world, trying to destroy them, trying to wipe them off the face of the map. And if Iran has their way, they'll annihilate them. But there's a spy in the sky called Jesus. Verse 3, chapter 30 of Deuteronomy. That then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity and have what? Look at that word. Have what? Compassion upon thee, and will return and gather thee from where? All the nations, whether the Lord thy God has scattered thee. And World War I got the land ready for Israel. And you know, years ago a guy told me, and you know, even World War II, with all the disasters, millions of people killed, and all over the country people died in war, but even that war had a purpose. God used Hitler for a purpose. I never did understand that. Brother Gist said, you know, World War I, and when I was here, I was listening to him. World War I got the land ready for Israel to go back to. World War II got the people ready to go back to Israel. Prophetically, guess what? Moses got the word way back there thousands of years ago that they would go back in the land. Verse 3, chapter 30. Quite amazing, isn't it? The Bible is absolutely correct prophetically. Amen. Praise God. Quite amazing, isn't it? Now, they're there. God's prospering them. And you know what? God came down in the form of His Son, Jesus Christ, His Son. And guess what? Jesus Christ came, and He went back into heaven. And He's watching Israel now, and He's blessing them now. Verse 3, if you look at it. What did He say? I'll have what? What's the key word there? He would have what? Compassion on Israel. And He'll gather them up from all over the world, all over the nations. World War I got the land ready. World War II got the people ready. John and I went into the Holocaust Museum in Washington. And if you have a heart, halfway heart, you can't go through that without crying. I got through about the first part of it, and tears started coming streaming down my eyes as I looked at bodies stacked up and bodies being burned. And it was just terrible to imagine what they went through. And I saw it, and I had a little documentary, a little biography of a Jewish, young Jewish boy that went through that time period. And I was reading his story as I was going through, looking at the artifacts from World War II and from what Hitler did to the Jewish people. And, I just couldn't go through it without crying. And I'm all hard-hearted, and, you know, I've been a policeman and saw a lot of things. And it takes me a lot to just break me down to cry. But I did, after seeing such horrible massacres of the Jewish people. 2/3 of them were slaughtered during World War II. It was hard for me to imagine that even during those times that God would actually take that time and use that terrible time to get a people ready to go back to the land of Israel to fulfill this prophecy, because they never would have went back had that war not had happened. That stirred up the Jews that were left to go back to the land. And God now is having compassion on them, and they in that land. I won't tell y'all what. If God did that, He brought them back in that land. And there are great mighty nations that say, you know what, we don't want y'all. Y'all don't have the right to exist. Guess what? I have the same sentiment toward them as I have some in our own country. Now, I'll not get back in politics tonight, but I have the same sentiment toward those who want to destroy Israel. That any party or any people or anybody says, let's exclude God, shame on you.
Amen.
We have a great God.
Amen.
And we have the Bible. We have the Word of God. And the Word of God not only is scientifically right, not only historically right, but also is prophetically right. The Gentile world. Now we have just here in Deuteronomy, the first five books of the Bible, we have the history laid out already in the Old Testament. In the first five books of the historical account of Israel. We already see that they were hounded by all nations, that they were a great and mighty nation, and now they're back in the land. They're still in the land. One of the greatest miracles of all time is for the Valley of Dry Bones to come back in Israel to get life and to go back into the land. Great prophetical accomplishment for the nation of Israel to be back in Israel. What an amazing, astounding event to prove that the Bible is 100% prophetically accurate. Daniel prophesied that Babylon would rise, that the four superpowers of yesterday would rise, Babylon would rise, the Medo-Persians would rise, the Greece would rise, and that Rome would rise, and they would be the four superpowers of the world. Daniel predicted that Alexander would be defeated, and it would be divided up in four super kingdoms. And he also predicted that Greece, and he predicted the Medo-Persians would rent the kingdom from the Babylonians. Daniel said that, you know, you weighed in the balances and found wanting. The book of Daniel clearly spells out the four superpower kingdoms that would come into power and what would happen to them. So the Bible is prophetically accurate. Now, let me tell you something. Don't ever doubt this book. It's a good book.
Amen.
It's an accurate book. Everything in this Bible is 100% accurate. There are many scholars that studied and put this book together. The 66 books of the Bible, 39 Old Testament books, the 27 New Testament books are 100% accurate. Praise God for this wonderful gift. Every good and perfect gift cometh from above, from the Father of light, to whom is no variableness nor shadow of turning. Thank the Lord for this wonderful gift, the Bible, that is so prophetically right, is so historically right, and is so scientifically right. We know that Jesus Christ, the prophecy of Jesus Christ, was fulfilled. We know in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, that God prophesied and Moses recorded what God said. He said that Satan's head would be bruised by the seed of the woman. We know that Jesus Christ came 2,000 years ago. That through His seed, the Lord Jesus Christ, through her seed, the Lord Jesus Christ came into this world. We also know that all the kings of Israel would come from Judah. I don't know what tribe Netanyahu's from. I'd like to trace his genealogy. I would almost bet you he come from the tribe or the lineage of Judah.
Amen.
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 He's a reigning king. And I can tell you one without any doubt, they have a king that's coming. Guess who he is? He's a spy in the sky, Jesus. He's coming back. That's prophecy. That the kings would come out of the tribe of Judah. 100% prophetically accurate. Jesus Christ was born the tribe of Judah, the tribe of David. And I can tell you back that David will come during the millennial and rule and reign with the Lord Jesus as a viceroy. He will rule and reign from the throne. The scepter of David will never part. The Bible is 100% accurate concerning the Lord Jesus. It said that the Jewish people would reject Him in Isaiah 53, that He was despised and rejected of who? His own people. It said He would be born of a virgin. He was born of a virgin. It said He would be rejected of His own people. Also, it said that He would do miracles. He would cause the blind to see and the lame to walk. And all these things have come true. Absolutely 100% prophetically accurate. It also says in there in the Bible that He would be sold for 100 for 30 pieces of what? silver, which was happened. It also said that he would be crucified between what? Two thieves. He was crucified between two thieves. Now look with me. Psalms chapter 16, if you would. Verse 10. Psalms chapter 16. Turn over there with me. Some sweet, wonderful verses. Because you know what, saints, tonight? That same spirit that raised the Lord Jesus will also raise you. He was raised from the dead, praise God. You know what? Psalm 16:10 said that his soul would not see corruption. He would live. I'd like to show you that in Scripture. Psalm 16:10, if you would, look with me. I want you to look at these precious prophetical truths that all of them were fulfilled. Verse 10, chapter 16, Psalms. Look at it in your Bible. You know what? You ought to underline this. You ought to look at this. How did they know? How did, you know, way before Christ came, in the book of Psalms, it was written in God's Word, verse 10, "For thou would not leave my soul were in hell." Praise God. He did not stay in hell. It was prophesied, prophetically correct. Did he rise? He rose. "Neither will thou suffer thy Holy One to see" what? Corruption. Prophetically correct. You mean the Bible's absolutely correct? Now what? If we only had hope of Jesus Christ in this life, Paul said, we would be all of all men most what? Miserable. Praise God for his resurrection. Psalms chapter 24, if you would turn there and look with me. And look at Psalms 24 as we look in verse 7. Not only did he rise from the dead, not only was his soul not left in the grave, not only did his body not see corruption, but he went into heaven. He ascended. 500 people saw him ascend. Now, a court of law, you need two witnesses. But we saw 500 people saw him rise up out of the grave, praise God. All these things come to pass. Everything in the Bible is 100% prophetically correct. One day you'll stand before the Lord. One day Danny Perry will stand before the Lord. I'll stand at the judgment seat of Christ. I'm saved, praise God. Not by what I've done, but because of what Jesus did at the cross. 2,000 years ago, I'm completely justified before God. I'm absolutely in good standing with the Lord. Now, I still have problems. I'm in the flesh, and I still sin. Now, I try to walk in the spirit, man, as much as I can. The Bible says that, you know, if you're going to preach the gospel, you need to live the gospel. I want to be justified before my fellow men. I want you to see that I have a walk with God. That I know what I'm talking about. I use the Bible. The Holy Lord lives in me. The Spirit of God lives in me. And I want to be justified before you as you see my life and you see my book, how I live. That, you know, I do have compassion. I do love you. I do love my fellow man. I want to do good to as many men as possible. I want to serve in this church and preach the gospel in this church and minister to you and love you. I want to be justified before you. And the way I'm justified before you is you see my works. But I'm justified before God by not doing any work. Praise God. I'm justified before God because I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. I believe everything that the Old Testament said, everything that the Old Testament is full of Jesus Christ. You know what? Folks say, well, the Old Testament don't belong. That's hogwash. Without the Old Testament, the New Testament could not have came. Amen. The Old Testament prepared the way for Jesus. John the Baptist prepared the way for Jesus. The Bible is 100% accurate when it concerns Jesus. The Bible is 100% accurate when it describes, even back in Deuteronomy, it describes Israel's course, that all nations would be up against them. They wouldn't be at rest, that nations would come against them. Everything in the Bible describes what Israel went through. Everything in the Bible describes the Gentile history. 100% accurate. No error in it. It is amazing what this Bible tells us. Praise God. Amen. So as we look at, and we look in Psalms 22, verse 7, and we look at the prophecy about his resurrection. Psalms 24, verse 7. Psalms 24, verse 7. "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be you lift up, you everlasting doors, and the King of who? Glory shall come in." Who is this King of glory? Jesus. "The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, even lift them up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall" do what? "He shall come in." Who is the King of glory? Jesus. "The Lord of hosts, He is the King of glory. Selah. Think on these things. He rose from the dead. And he went into the very portals of heaven. Lift up you gates. Jesus Christ lives. And he reigns in heaven. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Now I tell you what. Where y'all at with me tonight?
Amen.
This makes me excited.
Amen.
That same Jesus that rose from the dead, that the prophetical book in Psalm said that he will not leave his soul in hell, neither shall his body seek corruption. He ascended up into heaven. He entered into the everlasting doors, praise God. He took his body and presented it before the Father. He shed royal blood on the cross. And he shed his blood and on the mercy seat in heaven. He's prepared a way for me and you. And I believe this with all my heart that Jesus Christ is the way, truth, and life. He is the everlasting door. Hallelujah. And if we believe in him, we'll never perish. Praise God. That's why this book is precious. That's why this book is the truth. Now, bear with me just a minute. We're going to read a little bit. Not only scientifically correct and historically correct, but prophetically correct. Luke 24 and 50, if you want a second witness on this, let's kind of look at this. And maybe you'll fall in love with this grand book and the words that it says. Now hold on a minute. If you're not saved here tonight, all this book is a set of rules to you. And you have no joy in reading it. And it's not alive to you. But since the Holy Spirit lives in me, every time I read a verse in this book, every time I meditate on a verse in this book, it's like these words jump right off the pages, right into my spirit. Every time I open the book up, it's like opening this book up for the first time. It is an amazing book. It's an exciting book. Now, you know what? When I was young, when I was dead in sin, before the Holy Ghost saved me and stirred me up and filled my spirit, I didn't enjoy reading this book. But now, since I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus, this is God's love letter to me. The second witness that he lives, that he reigns on high. Luke 24, 50. Look with me. And he led them out as far as Bethany. And he lifted up his hands and blessed them. And it came to pass while he blessed him, he was parted from them and carried up where? Into heaven. Praise God. Lifted up into heaven. Not only is the Bible prophetically correct, not only is it all the historically correct, not only is it scientifically correct, but it also has given us great gifts. And I'll tell you what now. Listen to me very closely, what I'm about to say. Thank God for Bach, who gave us the organ and the piano. Amen, Sister Carolyn? Thank God for Bach, who gave us all this rich music. He was a Lutheran zealot who loved the Lord, and he gave all his musical talents to serve the Lord. And I'll tell you what, Seth and our young people, if you get them off this music where it sounds like a cat's got his tail in the door, and let them listen to Bach with music that got order in it, your kids will be a lot more sane.
Amen.
They did a little experiment. They put hard rock in a little closed-up building and put flowers all around it for 30 days, and they played hard rock day after day, and the flowers began to wilt. And they put Bach, who was a Lutheran zealot who used his music, and that's where we got our good music from. And they put Bach and music with organization in it, and the flowers flourished, and then they begin to wrap around the music. The Bible gives us our music. The Bible gives us our culture. The Bible gives us order. Every good and perfect gift coming from above, from the Father of lights. If we as Christians would just do one thing for our youth, start playing music with order in the Elizabeth Church, we're rich with musicians. Don't squander what we have here. This church is rich with talent to sing. We got young people coming up, and we need singing schools here for our young people. every major college that has any salt, every major college that prospers, they always have a good music department. Am I right? Study history. Study schools. Music is a vital part of learning. We got this blessing from the Bible. Amen. From Bach, who was a Lutheran zealot who loved the Lord. So this Bible is a wonderful gift to men. Amen. Now, it could be that the Western world would have stayed in darkness had not a man got the Macedonian call. Who was he? Paul. Thank you. Look with me in Acts. And we could have stayed in darkness. The Western civilization could have been left to its own. We in a great strait and a great peril in America today. Y'all listen close to me. Don't think for one minute that this is addressed to you to get you to vote Republican or Democrat. None whatsoever. I'm for someone that believes in the righteousness of the Bible and restore order back in America. And that's how I'm going to vote. But I seen some startling things last week that y'all better take heed to. We are going in the wrong direction. I just want to warn you as your pastor, cry aloud, spare not, lift up your voice like a trumpet, what the Bible says. Amen.
Amen.
And they may come after me any minute because the world would listen to my sermons and they would classify me as someone narrow-minded and mean-spirited. But I'm not. I'm a very compassionate guy. And I don't want her to flee. Really. But we have to declare and preach the truth.
Amen.
Amen.
Even if it hurts. Acts chapter 20, if you would look with me. We in the Western world would have been in bad shape had not an apostle of the Lord not had come to our aid. He heard the Macedonian call. Now I begin reading in verse 1. And after the uproar was ceased, Paul called unto his disciples and embraced them and departed for to go to Macedonia, to the Western world, the Western civilization. Had not Paul went to Macedonia, the Western world would have been without the gospel. There it is, folks. Paul heard the Macedonian call and he went to the Western world. And he came into the Western coast and the gospel spread in the Western world. And the Western world began to receive the gospel. And from there, as one of our presidents quoted, we would have never came to these shores had not our fathers believed what the Bible says. They wanted freedom to worship what this Bible taught. And they left those familiar shores. And they come to a civilization, they come to a wilderness, which you call America, so they could worship God. Today in America, there are those that say, we don't need God anymore. Let's exclude God from our platform. I say to them, bless your heart, repent and change. I'm not going to follow that path.
Amen.
I'm going to follow what thus saith the Lord is, and I want God to be included.
Amen.
We have the Bible. And for any leader that says, let's exclude the Word of God, I say to them, goodbye.
Amen.
I love America.
Amen.
I love this country. And I love what this Bible teaches. And more than all that, even if America perishes, praise God, the Bible says, even if this country falters, if it fails, and we face something like Greece faced over there where there was total chaos and total anarchy and all the government systems broke down. God gives government. I'm not saying that. But if everything breaks down, if everything falls apart, we still have the promises of the Bible where it says, he's never saw his seed forsaken or his seed begging bread. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm going to go tonight praising God. I'm going to go to bed tonight praising God, knowing that my God will provide. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Amen.
Our dependence is not on what people or men can do. Our dependence is that we have a great God in heaven.
Amen.
And we have a wonderful Savior, the Lord Jesus. And he's still on the phone, hallelujah.
Amen.
And he's still interceding for fallen men. And everything prophetically has come true. Every good and perfect gift comes from above. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of light, to whom is no variableness, nor shadow of turning. And what he says is 100% accurate. It will never falter and it will never fail. Praise God.
Amen.
And tonight, as I close tonight, I can say to you tonight that I love the Lord more than anything in this whole world.
Amen.
And He is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And I'm saying to you tonight, get the rocks out of the road. Move them out. If you got stones in your life, clear the path and get ready for that Jewish fire in the sky, because He's coming back to this earth to get His people. Hallelujah. I'm excited about that. I'm overjoyed in the fact that I've been born again. I'm overjoyed in the fact that He went up into heaven and the door swung open and He entered into the everlasting kingdom. He stepped right in there, folks. And everything the Bible prophesied came true about the Lord Jesus. It came true about Israel. It came true about the Gentile world. And if a miracle turns from God, we're doomed. But if a miracle turns from God, God will take care of His remnant. We're just going to keep pressing on. Now, we may not drive a Cadillac, but we may have a bicycle. It might do us health-wise pretty good. And Buddy don't sell all his horses, I may go buy a horse from him.
I got one safeguard.
Hopefully I have all my kidney stones out by then.
We don't kidney stones to
heaven. Hey. Hallelujah.
One
good thing about a kidney stone, you know, there's a good thing about a kidney stone. It reminds me that it'd be a wonderful place to go to heaven, and hell's going to be a bad place if it's like kidney stones. So, you know, all things work for good to them that love the Lord, and it just makes me preach a little bit harder. You know what? You don't need to go to hell because there's pain there. Amen. Stand with me. And I'm close. Invite somebody to church next Sunday morning. Pick somebody up. Bring them with you to church. Every time I ask the Lord to help me on a matter, He's never failed me. Every time. Sometimes when I was a younger Christian, I wouldn't think God was answering my prayers. But after a few years, you know, been seasoned a little bit, I found out one thing to be true. That everything that I ask the Lord in faith, He always answers it. Even when it don't happen, He's answering it. He shows me something. Every time I ask the Lord to tender someone's heart or help me to talk to someone, He's never failed. Every time I went into a situation and didn't ask God to help me, I've always failed.
Amen.
I can tell y'all tonight that we have a supernatural God. That He loves you, that He cares for you, and that everything you ask, He gives an ear to it. He's a God that I don't have words in my vocabulary to even explain Him. I don't know why He gave us the Bible. I don't know why He would give us this precious book. This book is a manuscript from outer space. Don't treat this book lightly. Study it and believe it. It's 100% accurate. Prophetically, historically, and scientifically. And Jesus said this to the Pharisees and scribes. He said, "Search the Scriptures. For in those Scriptures you will find eternal life. And in those Scriptures that testify of me, that is the way of life."
Amen.
Don't take it lightly. There's a judgment coming, church. There's a judgment seat of Christ that you will stand. And there's a great white throne judgment where unbelievers will stand. Folks that aren't justified before God. You see, the thief on the cross was justified before God. He wasn't justified before men because he didn't have a chance to prove that he was justified. But he was justified before God.
Amen.
And he will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Everybody that refuses Jesus Christ will die and perish for eternity. Now, I wouldn't preach that so passionately if I didn't believe what this book says. But today and last week, we've looked at just a few things to prove that this Bible in past has been 100% accurate. And y'all listen close to me tonight. Just as sure that all the prophecies come true about Israel, all the prophecies became true about the superpowers of yesterday, just as sure as all those prophecies come true, folks, y'all listen to me tonight. We're all going to stand before that judgment seat of Christ. And Jesus Christ is going to reward us there. And we're going to get rewarded. And when we get rewarded, our quality of service will be for eternity. Just as sure as there's a judgment seat of Christ, Revelation chapter 20, verse 11, there's a great white throne judgment called the second death. And every man that stands at that great white throne judgment, God's a fair God. He's a God that's not impartial. He will give every man a judgment. If there's a man at the great white throne judgment that is holy without the shed blood of Jesus, he'll allow him to go into heaven. But you know what? There's no man that's going to be able to stand there and be justified. So tonight, if anybody's lost in here, you're going to get an opportunity of your lifetime. Hopefully everybody in here is justified before God. But there might be somebody in here who's never, ever been saved. I'm hoping I'm talking to 100% people who are saved. But you never know.
Amen.
There might be someone here tonight who needs to make peace with God who's never been justified. Someone who's still empty inside. I'm going to tell you what. When Jesus comes into your life, He fills you. And He changes you. Somebody tonight might need to say, Lord, it's me. I've never been saved. Would you save me? I'm a sinner. I believe that your Son died and rose again. I want to accept His salvation. I want salvation. As we sing, Brother Rod, come, let's sing. What about it, saints? What about it? Tonight's the night. If you've been standing carelessly and you're living loosely, and you're not sold out for the glory of God, and you just, you know what, you're going to slide by this life. You got saved years ago, but you're not interested in witnessing to nobody. You're not interested in serving the Lord. You're not interested in loving God. You're not interested in giving to the Lord. And if you don't care about serving God, then maybe you're a backslidden state. Because if you're saved, you want to harness up, and when you come in those doors, you know what you want to say? I'm Elizabeth, and I'm ready to serve.
Amen. Amen.
I'm in Elizabeth, and you know what? I don't want to be caught for 1 minute with any malice or hatred toward my brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to love them 100%. Amen?
Amen.
If you don't have that spirit and that attitude, you know what? You're in a backslidden state.
Amen.
You know what? It's time to repent and just love on the Lord tonight. Amen? Let's love Him. I'm glad to be here, y'all. So this is our invitation. Let's get right with God tonight. Saved folks, lost folks, there's your time. This is our invitation time. Brother Rod, let's sing.